I was mulling over these verses and what they mean and how they could connect with us this week. And so I was looking ahead to today and made a little YouTube video. Many of you may have seen on Facebook or in the various emails from the church. And I mentioned in the video that this line, the sea was no more. So let's just get that out of the way. Kind of address the elephant in the room. I have to say that when I've read this, every time I've read this over the years, I've had this feeling deep inside that this must be bad theology. I mean, what could it possibly mean? What good could there be of saying the sea is no more? But then again, this is in the John tradition, and there's always more than meets the eye in John. After digging a little bit deeper, I see that this isn't an affront to mariners and sailors and people who love the water. Like so many other cases in Revelation, the surface words can lead us astray, take our eyes off the mark. I said it just a few weeks ago when I was preaching out of the Gospel of John, I love the layers of meaning. John's apocalypse or revelation is different because it uses images to convey something about God. And here, in this passage, we have a beautiful promise. One that would be easy to miss if we did not climb into the historical context of the chapter. When it says, I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down from heaven, we have to set aside some of our modern notions. God's revelation has nothing to do with the modern nation state of Israel. In our view, the word Israel conjures up the Middle East, and conjures up news, and it conjures up all these ideas of what's happening today. However, we have to remind ourselves when we're reading Scripture that our modern sense of Israel started in 1948, and I'm not going to ask for a show of hands of who remembers that. In 66 of the Common Era, that is year 66, there was a Jewish uprising in Jerusalem, and it took over the city, occupied the holy city. It kicked out the Romans temporarily, but in the year 70, just a short 4 years later, the Romans besieged and conquered Jerusalem. Josephus, the great Jewish historian, describes the destruction. The army had no more people to slay, no one else to plunder, because there remained none to be the objects of their fury, for they would not have spared any. When Revelation 21:2 says, I saw the holy city, a new Jerusalem, it's not talking about that Jerusalem that was destroyed by the Romans. It's not talking about today's Jerusalem, that city that is the seat of so much turmoil and violence. Pablo Richard, the commentator on this passage, says, in Revelation, Jerusalem is like a man. It's a symbol for the people of God or the community. History isn't limited to being a society of men and women, but also includes the cosmos and nature. Just like Jim's testimony about the work his father did as a missionary, saving lives. The new cosmos and the new humankind are bodily. Transcendence means overcoming death, chaos, and darkness. Not overcoming bodiness and history. In the new world created by God in this chapter of Revelation, there is this sense of physical bodiness to it. If I can make bodiness into a word. And it's all about social relations. But they are now without death. Can you imagine? They are now without chaos. I can't imagine. Sometimes life feels like chaos one thing and then the other, and this was unexpected over the former. No more darkness, no more pain, no more suffering, no more of all those things that hurt. To talk about the cosmos or including nature in our faith sounds, again, making up a word, a bit New Agey to me. But that couldn't be further from the point of the faith in Revelation. Instead of something that we can wrap our minds around, this is about God. Last week I talked about the idea that God understands us. We don't have the capacity to fully understand God and wrap our minds around God. God is beyond our comprehension. Revelation is crisis literature written in a time of responding to this horrible oppressor, Rome. It's produced during a time of great difficulty. It's most likely was written at the end of the first century. So it was after this year 70, fall of Jerusalem. And in Revelation, we see that idea, Jerusalem, that fell and crumbled under the Roman weight. That's a symbol. I saw the holy city. Means God is here. God is present. This book, as unlikely as it may seem, based on some of the other interpretations, offers strength and hope in desperate times. Dana Ferguson writes about it. It's not a rosy description of heaven, like the kind where you walk past a window of a beautiful image and you say, well, now isn't that lovely? Sort of the old cartoonish picture of angels playing harps on clouds. That's not this revelation. That's not this vision of heaven. People often think that death is the worst thing that can happen. This passage is here to say no. No, death isn't the worst thing that can happen. God destroys death. We saw that when Jesus raised Lazarus. We saw that in the celebration of Easter when Jesus triumphed over death. We saw that when in Acts Peter raised Tabitha in our scripture reading just last week. In Acts 20, which isn't a passage we've read recently, we also see that when Paul raises a man named Eutychus. Now, that's not one of a preacher's favorite passages, in case you want some entertaining reading. Paul was preaching a late-night revival, and Eutychus was listening to Paul's sermon, and, well, you know Paul, he gets carried away sometimes, and Eutychus was listening while sitting in a window, and he, like some of you, dozed off and fell out the second-story window, and when he hit the ground, they pronounced him dead on arrival. Paul said, no, he is not dead. Death isn't the end. Paul was able to raise Eutychus. That doesn't mean you have a green light to fall asleep and fall out the window. Death is not the end. God's grace overpowers it. And now, lest we get too far into the transcendence and again start sounding New Agey, I'll clarify this. Eric Heim deals with the problem of claiming that our faith overcomes death. When we say God overcomes death, we might encounter some theological challenges. Because some might say, the Bible is wrong. Death is a part of the natural order. Can you imagine how crowded the world would be if we did not have death? Others might say, natural science is wrong. Death is not natural. In Revelation, you see a third alternative. And that's to take the understandings of both science and the Bible as appropriately descriptive. In this age, where we are right now, where we live today, death is a part of our lives. Death is a part of our world. Death is a part of the natural order of things. And that's what we learn in science. We don't deny our mortality. Nevertheless, death is not God's intent. It is not a part of God's design. And that is why we see in Scripture God overcoming death. No matter what, God holds each one of us. God holds each one of you. Jesus commands us to love one another. And that's a way of living out a response to God. In Revelation, we experience all these visions of grace, beautiful images of grace, real grace, powerful grace, not the picture of angels on a cloud off lofty somewhere, grace, but grace that connects with where you live, grace that connects with where you are every single day. This book was written to original hearers who would have been familiar with all these different types of literature. They would have known their Persian and Babylonian mythology. And so there are all these references that pour forth in Revelation. Just like we are familiar with our own cultural references. Maybe the novels of Dostoevsky or Grisham or whoever. But we aren't familiar necessarily with our Persian and Babylonian mythology. And so it's easy to miss some of the allusions and alliterations in the text. This passage is a vision of the New Jerusalem. It's a beautiful image, and it's about God's kingdom. Grace is that free gift that God offers to all of humanity. It's the gift of a relationship that goes on into eternity. And the new heaven reflects that grace in a powerful and vivid way. Heaven is where God is. The words don't do it justice. These visions of grace and revelation are about a world in which God's idea of reality becomes our idea of reality. And when our idea of reality becomes God's idea, we can start to see grace the way God sees it. The process of growing in our relationship puts us in the New Jerusalem described here. It's a reality that we can actually experience today. Travis Poling writes about this passage. I love this quote. "I am not convinced that the New Jerusalem is only a vision of what the end may look like. I believe it also is what the world looks like every single time our ways of seeing and believing and loving and living in this world come to an abrupt end, and God comes in to transform our lives. In this sense, the world ends over and over again." Our Christian lives are about this moment, right now. They're about experiencing God here, today, where you are. Now, I began by questioning this line, "The sea is no more." You know, it's interesting, Jimmy, because I still am not sure how I feel about a world in which the sea was no more. However, I can say beyond a shadow of a doubt that when we get into God's grace, when God's will becomes our will, whatever that looks like, whatever will be no more, will be okay. Because that vision of grace is so complete, is so full, it'll connect with everything we could possibly want, every desire, every wish. That's what God wants for us. That sense of transformation, that sense of experiencing it right now. So, I'll say, "The sea is no more."